I sometimes ask myself whether the unicorn really did exist and simply disappeared, like the dodo or the Tasmanian tiger. Julius Caesar mentions the unicorn, and it has been said that he rode one during the conquest of Gaul. Marco Polo caught a glimpse of one in China, and even the great Leonardo da Vinci dedicated to the creature an article for what could very well have been the first modern encyclopedia of nature, if he had finished it. In each of those accounts, the authenticity of which cannot be denied, the unicorn reveals itself as fierce and untamable, powerful as a bull, fearless and elusive, all features that made it the most dangerous game ever hunted, and therefore the most desirable. So it's logically from here, at the Museum of Hunting in Paris, that our modern quest for the unicorn begins. No one denies that Elizabeth I and Henry VIII of England and Charles IX of France each owned unicorn horns, as did all the mighty whose worst fear was to be poisoned. They acquired them for the price of gold and much more. Tradition held that a chunk of unicorn horn, when dipped in royal water, could purify it of all possible poisons. And history tells us that all those horns came more or less directly from Danish traders who made enormous profits from their sale. Indeed, the market for unicorn horns was so important to Denmark that even the monarchy was likely involved. The royal castle of Rosenborg still bears witness to this trade. So I set off to Copenhagen in search of more clues about the existence of the unicorn.
Oprindeligt bestilt af Frederik III i 1660'erne. Og Frederik III var inspireret af kong Salomon. Kong Salomon, som vi kan læse om i Det Gamle Testamente. Og der står i kongernes bog, at Salomon sad på en trone af guld og elfenben og omringet af 12 løver af purt guld. Så han fik bygget en trone af guld og elfenben, og ikke af guld i form af ægte guld, men af forgyldt metal. Og heller ikke elfenben fra elefanter, men noget, som var endnu mere kostbart, nemlig enhjørningehorn.
In the basement of the castle, buried in its vast collection of artifacts, my guide shows me a tiny sailing boat carved out of unicorn horn. The boat was created for the Princess of Denmark and was launched into vats of wine before she drank from them. Its natural power obliterating any poisons the liquid might contain. If the unicorn was once an animal that haunted our forests, it can no longer be found there. Equally, it has vanished from all modern books of natural history. But what about books of the Middle Ages? Or even more likely, those of ancient times? In search of clues, I go back to Paris and to the National Library. Here I discover what some call the first travel book ever, and the last official sighting of the unicorn. Published in 1486, the book is an account of a two-year pilgrimage to the Holy Land, led by the wealthy canon of the cathedral at Mans, Bernard von Bredenbach. The book was renowned for its topographical accuracy and detailed illustrations, but what is interesting for our story is a collection of small sketches the pilgrims made of the exotic animals they saw on their journey. A giraffe. A crocodile. A humanoid ape, a salamander, a camel, two Indian goats, and a unicorn. At first, they thought it must have been a camel. But their guide, pointing to the animal's single horn, said in fact, it was a unicorn. Going back 20 centuries to the 5th century BC, I stumble across the account of a unicorn by the Greek physician named Theseus. This is the first known recorded description of a unicorn. He writes, "There exists in India a wild donkey, tall as a horse, and even taller. Its body is white, its head purple, and its eyes dark blue. The horn is multicolored, white at the base, crimson at the tip, and black in between." Theseus added that anyone who drank out of the horn would be immune to poisons and would not suffer convulsions. He also mentioned other creatures, the manticore, a sort of lion with a human head. Theseus most likely never saw the unicorn himself, as he never traveled to India, so far as we know. Rather, he collected accounts from other travelers and let his own imagination roam. His account, like the rest of his works, reached us through a Christian patriarch from the 9th century AD, a man called Photius, who transcribed it. Since then, most of Theseus' writings have disappeared. Some 50 years later, in his great work Classifying Species, The History of Animals, Aristotle dismissed Theseus' description of the one-horned creature as pure fantasy. But he did not doubt that a one-horned creature from India existed. He wrote, "We have never seen an animal with a solid hoof and two horns, and there are only a few that have a solid hoof and one horn, such as the Indian ass and the oryx." Later, Pliny the Elder wrote that the wildest animal from India is the monoceros, or single horn. It has the body of a horse, the head of a deer, and one single black horn of 2 cubits erected on its forehead. The feet of an elephant, the tail of a boar, a low, bellowing roar. It cannot be captured alive. Later still, about 2 centuries AD, the Roman Claudius Aelian accepted Theseus' unicorn as a creature who lived in the remote mountains of India. It was as large as a horse and as swift as the wind. It had red body hair and mane, feet like an elephant's, a tail like a goat's, and a single black horn. Aelian adds a significant detail. His creature's horn had a spiral pattern. Finally, the Bible itself mentioned the unicorn on not less than 8 occasions. Therefore, who would dare deny its existence? How did the unicorn emerge from the wilds of distant India to acquire such importance in the forests of northern Europe and in the pages of the Christian Bible? My search for answers this time takes an unexpected turn. It takes me to the New World. At the northern end of New York's Manhattan Island, there is a large park which stretches up to the river. It once belonged to John D. Rockefeller, Jr. In the 1920s, Rockefeller built a French cloister of the Middle Ages, stone by stone, out of the bits of mini cloisters he acquired from the collection of an antiques trader who managed to transport his treasures across the Atlantic just a few months before French law would forbid it. In In this architectural patchwork, now run by the Metropolitan Museum of Art, in a room dimmed to protect them from light, seven sublime tapestries tell amazing stories which have one and only one star, the unicorn. The curator of the cloisters, Tim Husband, not only allowed me to film the tapestries, but also, as a rare favor, allowed me to light them up for a few precious minutes, revealing their glittering beauty almost intact.
They cost an enormous amount of money to produce.
And time.
And they demanded a palatial setting in which to show them. So tapestries, more than any other form of works of art at the time, spoke eloquently of the owner's financial and social status.
And lights.
The beginning of The Hunt and the Captive Unicorn weaves together a love story in a garden of a thousand flowers, mille fleurs, the only place where one can flirt, a word which has its roots in the French fleur, or flower. The hunters in this tapestry embody love. Their arrows, like Cupid's, do no physical harm. The unicorn is the lover, subdued by his beloved, who keeps him imprisoned in the hortus conclusus, the Latin for enclosed garden. The beloved is not in the picture. She might have been in a third, missing tapestry, showing how she chained her lover. What we actually see is the result. The beloved has tied the lover to a tree, his bonds symbolizing the fidelity of a marriage oath. Wounded by love, the unicorn lover will live happily in the garden of a thousand flowers, the original white picket fence, which protects our lovers from the cruelties of the outside world.
And lights.
Things get more serious in the following four images. At first sight, they deal with a traditional hunt, which doesn't look much different from, say, a fox hunt. But they would have been perceived very differently by a viewer in the 15th century. The unicorn is spotted in a clearing by a fountain before which he has kneeled. He dips his horn into the water to purify it, allowing the wild beasts to drink without fear. Surrounding the scene, the gentlemen hunters realize the sacred nature of what is happening before their eyes. They restrain themselves from disturbing this holy ritual. In the following image, we find ourselves all of a sudden in the depths of the forest. The animal is being stalked. The hunters torment their prey under the initials of the owner of the tapestries, on the tree trunk and at the corner of the tapestries. The animal is wounded, for real this time. Jumping into the brook, it tries by this ruse to escape his tormentors. But the ruse fails. Other hunters are waiting on the other bank, where they unleash fresh hounds. Now the animal is cornered. In a desperate attempt to escape capture, he fights back with his powerful legs and razor-sharp horn. The hounds, maddened, harass him. One of the hunters blows his horn to call for help or to reunite the hunting party. Eventually, walking slowly behind the animal out of breath, a man serves him with a sword in the pure tradition of this type of hunt. A horn is blown to announce the death of the unicorn, and his lifeless corpse is transported on the back of a horse. At first glance, it seems like the victorious end of a normal hunt. But what does the man holding the unicorn horn with his left hand say to the man next to him, while pointing an accusing finger in the direction of the lady at the head of the procession outside the castle? Is he accusing her of being responsible for the slaughter? She must feel guilty of something, because she is counting her rosary beads, and her face shows deep sorrow, as do the faces of the people in the crowd behind her, in awe before the body being brought to the castle. The fatalistic, resigned gaze that the lady casts toward her husband, himself in shock before an event he couldn't prevent, makes her a figure of sorrow disproportionate to the simple death of a hunted animal. A Mary Magdalene before the cross couldn't look more devastated than this lady. And this reminds anybody who cares to look of the sacred nature of the animal.
We only have two small fragments of what we think was at least a 10-foot wide tapestry. So we don't know what the figures, or if there were figures, who they were. In its simplest form, it may simply be a visual telling of the legend of the taming of the unicorn. If there were more figures involved in the original tapestry, it could well be the symbolism of the hortus conclusus. So now, if I had to guess, I would say it was an expanded iconographic program, very much like the tapestry in Zurich.
Also aufgrund des Stiles und der Technik des Teppichs gehen wir davon aus, dass er in Basel entstanden ist. Basel war ein wichtiges Wirkereizentrum im 15. Jahrhundert. Und wir wissen auch genau, wann das Stück entstanden ist. Das Stück ist nämlich datiert 1480. In dieser christlichen Interpretation ist es ja so, dass der Moment, wo das Einhorn zur Jungfrau flüchtet und die Jungfrau das Einhorn, also das Horn, berührt, ist das eigentlich der Moment der Empfängnis, der Moment der unbefleckten Empfängnis.
The hunter, blowing his horn, becomes the angel Gabriel, sent to announce to the Virgin that she is bearing the Son of God. His four hounds embody the four daughters of God, truth, justice, peace, and mercy, and who ought to punish the sons of Adam for their sins or take them back to paradise. Behind the locked gate and the fortress walls of the enclosed garden, or hortus conclusus, the Virgin is protected from the cruelties of the outside world. The dove of the Holy Spirit guides Jesus as child towards the head of the Virgin, seat of the soul. With the marvelous economy of that period, one single image shows several actions separated in time and space. Here is the Annunciation, the conception, and the sacrifice of God. Adam, the first man, stabs the unicorn as God, saying, "He was wounded because of our sins." Whilst the first woman, Eve, collects his blood in a chalice, saying, "And by his blood we are redeemed." The New York tapestry, woven in the same period, might have, in a much more elaborate and refined style, told a similar story when it was complete. The two fragments, which measure together over 4 feet wide and whose height is a bit more than half the complete picture might have been, the accumulation of signs dear to the Middle Age Christians, the hortus conclusus, or enclosed garden, protected from the outside world by intertwined white and red roses, white for purity, red for charity, the apple tree in the middle of the composition, the treachery shown on the face of the woman, accomplice with the hunter blowing his horn, and whose hounds dared to enter the enclosed garden while stalking the unicorn, allows us to see in this image a Christian allegory. At this point, I may as well go one step further and insert the missing parts.
Maybe you can simply flip them. Flip it so that the hand will be in the right direction.
Using the Zurich tapestry as my guide, I first fill in the rest of the unicorn. The hand, tenderly stroking his mane, belongs to Mary, the Virgin Mother. On the other side of the apple tree, and to the left of Mary, and as counterpart to Eve, I put Adam holding a spear aimed at the unicorn as Christ. The unicorn is now at the height of his glory. There is a place in the 13th arrondissement of Paris where time has stopped. Here, tapestries are crafted in the most demanding way, the way they have always been. It's the Manufacture des Gobelins, founded in 1601 under Henri IV, in order to save on huge bills paid to Flemish weavers who were, at the time, the only ones to master this art. The tapestries of the cloisters were made one century before the opening of the Gobelins with a similar technique. The art of tapestry, one of the most subtle and demanding ever conceived, was the privilege of the mighty. It reached its peak in Europe in the Middle Ages and during the Renaissance. Falling out of favor in the 18th century, many of the masterpieces burned by French revolutionaries looking to harvest the gold and silver within the threads of wool. The tapestries were generally commissioned to give glory to their powerful owners. A few streets away from the Gobelins in the Museum of the Middle Ages, there are six tapestries as refined as those in the cloisters. They were woven in Flanders, too. But in spite of their name, the lady with the unicorn, our unicorn only gets a supporting role alongside the lion. The two of them carry the cipher of three crescent moons of the tapestry's owner. This is a role the unicorn and lion have had on many occasions, the most famous being the present coat of arms of the English crown. We can find in one of the tapestries a baby unicorn whose horn hasn't grown yet. He is a familiar animal, if not domestic, and now very fashionable. It was essential for upper-class ladies to be represented side by side with a unicorn. Five of those marvelous pieces are allegories of the senses, as told from a Christian moral perspective. Seeing, hearing, taste, smell, and touch. In sight, the most noble sense, the animal takes the shape of a graceful white horse, whereas in touch, the most vulgar, bestial of our senses, he takes the proportion and look of a dusty and hairy goat. To represent touch, it seems to have been obvious to the artist to show the lady caressing in a very erotic way the shamelessly erect horn of the unicorn. The Virgin Mary did it before her and remained immaculate. In sight, the unicorn plays again his best part, a powerful creature charmed and betrayed by a damsel who caresses his neck with one hand, holding a mirror with the other, and in which the unicorn contemplates his own image with rapturous delight, as if he were about to enter heaven. But the lady here seems to show some remorse for her treachery. In the sixth tapestry, the most beautiful and most complex riddle of all, the lady gives up her most precious possession, her jewels. She shows by this gesture of renunciation of human vanity her high moral standard. The unicorn, by now an embodiment of Christ and a symbol of virginal purity, is the ideal guarantor of her virtue, a symbolism which was newly fashionable in high society. Here, aware of his role, the unicorn is holding aloft the coat of arms of the lady's husband. It was possible, this time, to track down the person who commissioned these tapestries. The three crescents blazoned seen all over the tapestries was found on an engraving, a copy of a frieze sculpted on the grave of a man called Jean Leviste. This high-ranking magistrate of the 15th century strove hopelessly for an aristocratic title. He was buried in a church called the Celestin. It was destroyed during Haussmann's reconstruction of Paris around 1860, but the statuary from the church is now kept in the Louvre. Jean Leviste's grave was lost, but not far from where it had once been is another grave for René de Longueville, who was only 7 years old when death claimed her. A unicorn sits at her feet, a testament to her purity. But how did the unicorn make its way into the Christian world in the first place? To try to figure out this complicated problem, I met with Brother Michel Alberic, a Dominican monk and scholar of biblical history.
J'ai peut-être... Ah, mais j'en ai une en hébreu, là.
Vous avez ici... PS avec un petit trait dessus qui donne les références au livre des psaumes. Donc, avec cet outil de travail, on va pouvoir aller à la chasse à la licorne. Dans les livres bibliques, on sait où trouver le mot.
When it came to translating the Old Testament from Hebrew to Greek in the 4th century before the birth of Christ, 72 scholars known as the Septante gathered in Alexandria, Egypt to do the job. Legend has it that they all produced exactly the same translation. This meant they all tripped up over the same word, re'em, which in Hebrew means wild ox, an ancestor of our domestic cattle, but which no longer existed in their time. Searching for the Greek equivalent to this extinct animal, the scholars made a singular yet hugely important typo.
Alors là, vous avez REM, vous avez...
REM est ici, voilà.
Oui. Vous avez ici naricornis.
Alors ça, ça veut dire une licorne?
Oui, quasi naricornis, une licorne. Mais c'est peut-être là, naricornis rhinocéros, nari.
D'accord, nari, vous avez raison. Et en grec?
Et en grec, monokeratos, qui est traduit ici en latin par unicornis. Saint Jérôme, qui a traduit la Bible, a donné plusieurs traductions. Il a fait la première sur le grec, puis ensuite il a appelé l'hébreu, et il a fait une nouvelle traduction sur l'hébreu. C'est la traduction qu'on appelle la Vulgate, celle qui est en usage courant dans l'Église catholique. Le mot ici, dans cette version sur l'hébreu, copie un peu le grec. Mais ici, dans cette traduction, c'est « uni cornis cornum meum ». Sicut unis cornum meum.
D'accord.
Dès le début du XVIIIe siècle, la licorne, l'existence de la licorne est quand même mise en doute. Il existe un livre tout à fait extraordinaire qui s'appelle « Les physiques sacrées » ou « Histoire naturelle de la Bible », traduite du latin de Jean-Jacques Schoetzer. C'est publié à Amsterdam en 1734.
1734, ok.
Cet ouvrage qui est énorme, qui fait 8 volumes, est illustré de pas loin d'un millier de planches, près 800, 850, je ne sais plus exactement, et est une sorte de dictionnaire, d'encyclopédie, qui suit la Bible mot à mot, et qui, à chaque mot où on parle d'une chose physique, il y a un article et une représentation. Aquila a choisi parmi les animaux de cette espèce le rhinocéros. Saint Jérôme met indifféremment la licorne, monocéros, et le rhinocéros. C'est pourquoi l'on trouve dans le texte de notre version latine rhinocéros et, à la glose marginale, monocéros, la licorne. Voilà le rhinocéros. Voilà divers animaux à cornes. Et enfin, voilà nos licornes. Le commentaire qui suit met en doute déjà l'existence de cet animal fabuleux.
Mais donc, quand on publie une Bible aujourd'hui, on va continuer à remettre licorne parce qu'on traduit...
Non. Quand on va... La Bible que nous avons ici, qui est la traduction de la Bible de Jérusalem, le mot licorne n'apparaît pas. Oh, vous allez voir. Ouais. On va s'amuser. Tagada, tagada, tagada. Ça... C'est la concordance de la Bible, mais en français. Et c'est une concordance moderne. Je parie mes bretelles qu'il n'y a pas la licorne dedans.
Mais vous ne portez pas de bretelles.
C'est pour ça que j'ai pas grand-chose à perdre. Sauf mon pantalon. Liberté librement liée. A, B, C, D. Licencié, licteur.
D'accord.
Le mot licorne, dans les travaux modernes, a complètement disparu.
D'accord.
Hein? Vous voyez, il n'y est plus.
Bon.
I stumbled upon a black and white photograph of Saint Catherine, taken from a painting which now hangs in the Borghese Gallery in Rome, but as the painting would have appeared back in the 1930s. In this picture, Saint Catherine, the patron saint of the Borghese family, holds her right hand on the wheel of torment, the instrument by which she was martyred. In 1935, the great art historian Roberto Longhi examined the portrait which he attributed to Raphael, a great admirer of Leonardo da Vinci and to whom this painting was paying an obvious tribute, reproducing an identical pose and setting of the Mona Lisa. Peering beneath the rough touch-ups of the 17th century, the researcher discovered something rather curious. A shawl had been wrapped around the young woman's naked shoulders, and, more surprisingly, the original painting did not feature a wheel of torment at all, but rather a small unicorn cuddled up on the lap of the beauty as a pet. From this, we can conclude that the painting was originally a tribute from a husband to his virtuous bride, and not to a saint at all. But by the 17th century, the unicorn had become persona non grata. It was hastily painted over and scrubbed from history. Back in the late 16th century, the persons responsible for the sudden reversal of fortune were two prominent scientists. The Italian doctor, Andrea Marini, of whom I could not find a portrait, and Ambroise Paré, who both published essays daring to challenge the existence of the unicorn despite its well-known presence in both the Old and New Testament. Ambroise Paré, personal surgeon to the Medici family, stopped short of denying completely the unicorn's existence, but he did question the healing powers attributed to its horns, a subject on which the Bible was vague. He writes,
"Someone will tell me that the horns I used for my proof weren't real unicorn horns. I answer to this that the ones in Saint-Denis in France and the ones owned by the king, who is usually held in high esteem, and the ones Paris merchants sold at huge price are not real horns of unicorns. It is on those ones that I have made my experiments. And if one doesn't want to believe me, he only has to come to the proof as I did, and he will know the truth from the lie."
Suddenly, the unicorn could feel science nipping at its heels. With doubts rising, the price of unicorn horn plummeted. The unicorn started to lose ground. Embarrassed, the church quietly removed mention of the unicorn from new versions of the Bible. But the animal was not to leave the scene that easily. In the mid-17th century, bones not matching any known living creature were found in Schwarzfeld at the foot of the Harz mountain range in central Germany. Protestants and Catholics were at war, the former daring to question the Bible and such dogmas as the Immaculate Conception. But the bones seemed to have embarrassed both sides. In an era of pre-scientific thinking, a compromise was found. The bones, roughly put together, belonged, it seemed, to a two-legged kangaroo-like unicorn, a creature which must have drowned during the flood.
Nikolaus Steno, ein Mann aus Kopenhagen, zunächst evangelisch, konvertierte zum katholischen Glauben. Herr Leibniz lebte auch in Hannover damals und Sie hatten viele Gespräche. Herr Steno war der erste Geologe der Welt sozusagen. Herr Steno hatte schon in Italien sich die Bergformation angeguckt und er untersuchte das ganz genau, auch hier dann, und er fand eben heraus, dass die Erde früher anders aussah, als wie wir sie kennen. Und das ließ die Vermutung zu, dass die Erde viel, viel älter ist, denn er zählte die Schichten ab als das, was in der Bibel steht. Und das sorgte natürlich für Aufruhr. Und Herr Leibniz, die immer wieder überlegten, was sind das für komische Knochen, die wir finden? Und dann sagte man, alle Knochen, die wir in den Höhlen, in Steinbrüchen, unter Felswänden und im Sand finden, all diese Knochen, die man nicht heute lebenden, bekannten Tieren zuordnen kann, das alles ist Einhorn. Denn das Einhorn wird in der Bibel erwähnt. Und damit war Ruhe bei den Wissenschaftlern. Es war auch ein Glaubensstreit, der hinter der Erfindung dieses Einhorns steckte.
But what about those Danish traders? If the unicorn did not exist, what were they selling?
Let's see,
hold that bar.
And then I've got to go this way. This is a tricky point. Yeah. Do you want it on the white wall?
Just there? No.
Not like this.
As trade picked up between North and South Europe,
it became clear to everyone that the horns sold to the naive monarchs of the south were in fact the tusks of narwhals, small whales dwelling in the cold waters of the Arctic.
Den første kontakt mellem, jeg vil sige, skandinaver og inuit, det finder jo sted tilbage i 900-tallet, hvor Erik den Røde og hans familie og følgesvende sådan set rejser via Island til Grønland. Og på lange fangstrejser op til Thule, der møder nordboerne inuit for første gang. Og man kan forestille sig, at på disse rejser op langt nord i Grønland, der møder man også narhvalen for første gang. Der ser man narhvalen for første gang med den karakteristiske snoede tand. Og den bliver så et bytteobjekt mellem inuit og nordboer. Og det bliver jo så de kostbare enhjørningtænder, som så kommer og bliver handlet fra Grønland via nordboerne til Skandinavien og videre langt ud i verden som enhjørningtænder. Og det er den første kontakt, vi har der. Det går for sig i omkring 500 år. Den danske konge sendte allerede i 1600-tallet, faktisk slutningen af 1500 og begyndelsen af 1600-tallet, sendte han ekspeditioner ud, blandt andet for at eftersøge disse forsvundne nordboer. Men man mødte jo ikke nordboer, men man mødte igen inuit. Dengang var mødet lidt anderledes, da man handlede sig til noget, man stjal noget, men de kom til Danmark og til Europa, og på det tidspunkt var man allerede begyndt at blive klar over, at de snoede store, lange snoede tænder, de kom nok ikke fra enhjørninge, men fra fisk, som man sagde, som man skrev i 1600-tallet, de kom fra fisk, altså fra hvaler. Og hvis der er nogen, der kender narhvalens kulturhistorie og
In actual fact, the narwhal itself was an equally strange and mysterious creature. The accounts collected from the Inuit and transcribed by the Danish explorers are as fantastical as the ancient Greek description of the unicorn. The creature was given a horn rather than a tusk, and only through time did it transform itself into the animal we know today.
Jeg laver et studie om narhvalgenetik tilbage i tiden, hvor jeg skal se på, hvordan narhvalerne så ud fra i dag og så flere tusind år tilbage. Når vi har taget prøverne, så skal det køres på nogle maskiner, som man kalder PCR-maskiner, og så kan man ud fra det se, om har der været noget DNA i min. Derefter kan man så finde ud af, hvad det er, man har i sin prøve, og jeg skulle gerne have narhval i min prøve, men måske viser det sig, at det er indhjørning eller gris eller ko. Det har det ikke været indtil videre. Der har det været narhval.
But it is only in the beginning of the 19th century that the unicorn received its final blow. The great anatomist Georges Cuvier articulated a scientific rule that still stands today. Any animal with cloven hooves could not have a single horn, and animals with plain hooves could have none. The legend of the unicorn flourished not only in Christian territories. It exists in Japan, where it is still the logo of a famous beer, the Kirin. It looks more like a dragon and hardly resembles a unicorn, except for the single horn on its forehead. Today, for my neighbor, the word Kirin refers to a giraffe. In the Middle Kingdom, this dragon is called Kilin, and as fearsome as it looks, it is a peaceful creature that never treads on any living thing when it walks. When in 1415 a giraffe was brought from Africa by the Sultan of Malindi to the court of the Ming, they saw in that creature the reincarnation of their old myth, the Kilin. If one makes the effort to think in the way somebody of the Middle Ages or even the Renaissance thought, how could they possibly know that a creature as fantastical as a giraffe existed when a more believable creature like a unicorn didn't? It's only in 1827 when the first giraffe disembarked from a ship in Marseille and made its way to Paris and its brand new zoological garden that people had to believe the unbelievable. The giraffe was real. The unicorn, for his part, had to retreat to the foggy realm of fantasy. Rejected by the Christian churches which used to love him so much, he hid in the depth of woods, an outcast where now only children can see him.